News First, Newsline with Faraz Shaukatali.
Hello there and a very good morning. This is Newsline. I'm Sonali Vanigavadage. Our guest this morning is Mr. Javed Yusuf. He is a member of the Board of Governors of ONUR, which is the Office for National Unity and Reconciliation. A very good morning to you, Mr. Yusuf.
Good morning.
Thanks so much for joining us. Mr. Yusuf, it was the Office for National Unity and Reconciliation, or ONUR as it's known, that presented the National Reconciliation Policy on the 2nd of May. This year. Up to now, how has the implementation and acceptance of it been?
Now the policy itself was formulated by ONUR, our extensive process of consultation with various stakeholders over a period of about a year. And the policy was presented actually by the president himself to the cabinet,
right.
and it was adopted by cabinet. Now what we are doing is preparing the action plan to implement the policy itself. Now the policy is meant to give a direction to the government and to all agencies to take the reconciliation process forward. Now even before the policy was presented, as you know, there have been various initiatives both by ONUR as well as various arms of the government. For instance, I could say like returning of land in the north to people whose lands had been taken over, then the singing of the national anthem in Tamil. Like that, various initiatives have been taken even before the policy was formulated. But this is sort of to make it a holistic process, and so that all government ministries and departments can be informed of the thinking and the general thrust of what the government hopes to achieve. So that is the sum of what the policy is meant to be.
Okay, so these days the action plan is being formulated.
Yeah, that is what we are doing now.
Right, how long will that process take?
Well, that might take 6 months, because we always do this through a consultative process. Mm. But that doesn't mean that nothing happens in the meantime. Parallelly, there are the various initiatives which have been going on and will continue to go on, which will feed in to what actually the policy has sought to embody.
When we speak about national unity and reconciliation, Mr. Javed, how do you see participation of grassroots level communities across Sri Lanka? Because something that we often see is that when we speak about the concept of national unity reconciliation, the conversations always happen right on top. So it doesn't really filter down to the grassroots level communities. So the thinking happens to be very different. There seems to be a disconnect. How does this policy and this whole process try to be different from the usual scenario?
Yeah, we have been very conscious of that. And in fact, this process, as I said, the policy itself was formulated through a process of consultation of different stakeholders. At the same time, we have a programmatic aspect of the work of ONUR, which has involved training community leaders, government officials, as well as students. Because one of the critical areas that we see is young people have to have their attitudes changed in relation to how they view their communities, because the last 30 years of conflict, armed conflict, has sometimes tended to influence adults as well as young people in how they look at things. So we have actually had a big impact, because among the things are arts and culture programs, education programs with children, university programs. So we are very conscious that this has to take place through informed participation of grassroots, even religious leaders. Then we are also dealing with livelihood issues, and in the north and the east, even the formulation of development programs, which ONUR has tried to bring into the national planning process, has been done through consultations at that level with people of the area, officials of the area, community leaders of the area.
So do you see this as successful? How do you view it? I mean, right after the war, up to this moment, there have been multiple mechanisms to bring in reconciliation. Most recently, the government brought in the Office for the OMP Act, but the office is still not established, the Office for Missing Persons. We've had the presidential commissions of inquiry, we've had the Missing Persons Commission, we've had the LLRC, the Udalagama report, all of these initiatives at national level. However, we're still talking about the same old thing.
Well, that is partly true and partly not so true, because while we have been talking, and as you rightly said, we have been talking for a long time about this, there are things have happened, positive things have happened, and the tragedy is that we lost time immediately after the war was over. The next step should have been the healing of the wounds of the people.
Sure.
Sri Lanka, I would say, has been a great role model for the whole world when you look at history of coexistence, because all the communities have lived peacefully, in harmony, in friendship, brotherhood.
Absolutely.
From historical times. We never had these major ethnic or religious problems. Unfortunately, the war, the rights and wrongs of the war apart, it has created, as I said, wounded people, and as a result, they have tended to drift apart.
Sure.
So now reconciliation, that's what reconciliation is. Now when you talk about marriage, if there is a breakdown of relations in marriage, you try to reconcile the parties. Now this national endeavor is to reconcile the communities, both with each other and with the state.
Right.
Because don't forget the LTT exercise, the armed thing was against the state.
Sure.
Not really against the single people, but against the state.
Hmm.
So we have reconciliation at two levels, between the communities and with the state. And that's where the state has a very important part to do in leading this process. Because significantly, the state has to give leadership. The direction of reconciliation is based on what the state must give leadership, but of course at the grassroots level, communities also can have their programs, as we see all over different communities. Now this exchange of school children, that's very important. So that one of the best areas for reconciliation, when children of communities play together on the sports field, there you see the best comes out of them. And they don't look at this guy as from this community or that. So these endeavors are going on. We can't say that things have not been, you know. Of course, there are areas for improvement. Now you mentioned the Office for Missing Persons. Unfortunately, the law has been passed but not implemented. From what I hear and what I understand, there are some areas of concern which have prevented it from being sort of translated into actual action. But I think hopefully that is being addressed and it will move forward.
Also something that we must make note of is the role played by the former Foreign Minister Mangala Samaravira, who took a leadership role in taking Sri Lanka to the international community and really convincing the international community of the progresses made by Sri Lanka in the whole reconciliation national unity process. How do you view Sri Lanka as a sovereign nation in juxtaposition with the international community? Because we have been pressured by the UN Human Rights Council, etc., to sort of show results. How do you view this?
Well, one has to look at it this way, Sonali. Now, we as a country should do the correct thing, irrespective of what the world tells us. So it is in our own interest to do that. But in that process, we are also shaping our image internationally. And I think that is what has been happening under the leadership of the foreign minister. he has made a great endeavor on behalf of the government to change Sri Lanka's image by interacting with the world, and that has helped. And the fact that President Chandrika Bandaranaike Kumarakunga has been assigned the lead role in leading the reconciliation process also has a tremendous impact in the world. And the world recognizes now that both the President and the Prime Minister are genuinely committed to reconciliation. That is very clear from their talk, their action, their fearlessness. Now that the matter that I mentioned earlier, the singing, a simple thing like singing the Tamil, the national anthem in Tamil, was resisted on earlier occasions under the previous government. Now the government, despite some misgivings on part of some sections of the polity, have not had have had the courage to do that. So that's the signal that is being given. It will take a little time to have the whole process and a completed process. But we can see that we are moving ahead, because now, as you know, this Secretariat for Coordinating Reconciliation Mechanisms is in the process of formulating the other institutions necessary for this process. There is a Ministry of National Dialogue. So all these people, and the Ministry of National Integration itself, which is under the President, sure, also has its programs. I saw in the papers they are having some programs with religious schools like Dham Pasals and so on. So these are good signs, because don't forget that while this reconciliation process is being pushed forward by the government and sections of the community, there are also sections which are trying to undermine it. I don't personally believe that they don't want reconciliation, but because they want to use certain aspects of the reconciliation process to target it for political reasons. So it's a continuing battle and a challenge.
Mr. Yusuf, as someone who has worked in this area for decades, what is your opinion of the fact that there are concerns that over the recent past there have been numerous incidents from not just in Colombo but across several parts of Sri Lanka where incidents of racial hate and tensions have been reported, of course in isolation. However, there seems to be a slight trend. The President, the Prime Minister has given specific instructions for the police, the Inspector General of Police, to take stern action, for legal action to be imposed with equally to anyone without sort of considering designation, etc. How do you view this?
That's very unfortunate what has happened, particularly from around 2012. The Muslim community has been targeted. Those are the incidents we are looking at in recent times. Now, if you see the Tamil community, which was in direct conflict with the state, not the Tamil community but the LTT, but then the Tamil community suffered as a consequence of LTT's actions. The Muslims were caught in the crossfire. They were not really involved in the conflict, but they were victims. They were evicted from the north. There were those massacres in Katang, Kudiera, Hur, and so on. So really nobody has been spared of this conflict. So we need to heal the wounds, as I said earlier.
How do we move forward?
Yeah, so in a progressive now, way? Now when this spate of attacks have been happening, the first thing that needs to be done is to ensure law and order. Irrespective of one's standing, whoever breaks the law, whoever indulges in hate speech should be brought to book. Only then the situation can be brought to under control. Otherwise, it can charge the environment, and any small incident can create a situation which the government itself may not control, be able to control. We saw that in 83. You know, there was an isolated incident because there was a delay in government moving into action. It snowballed and the whole country has suffered.
So progressively, how do we take the country forward?
Yeah, I'm coming to that. So as I said, immediately action has to be taken. The police has to do its duty in bringing these people bring them to book. But in the long run, you see, there has been over the years a steady deterioration in institutions that are meant to ensure law and order and systems. Now, the change that took place in January 8, 2015 was not only meant to bring the President and the Prime Minister to power, but by bringing them to power, it was meant to create a change in the systems that operate. That is why the independent commissions have been set up, there have been various other administrative things taken, but still there are a lot to be done. The police, for instance, have got used to operating in a different way earlier, and they had wrong signals. Although in the police, even in the height of, during the last 2-3 years of the previous government, when these incidents were taking place, there were police officers who bravely try to bring the situation under control, but there were also people who did not. But now what I say is the police, for instance, I'm just giving one example, the institution has to be strengthened by retraining. Now they have to be made aware of the reconciliation policy that the government wants to implement. The judiciary has to be informed and of the reconciliation. So we should, as a nation, we should be in reconciliation mode. That is what I...
Okay, that's very interesting you should say that. We should be in reconciliation mode, that institutions such as the police, the judiciary should be trained and made aware of these new processes. What is the role that ONUR can play in convincing the government to have these in place?
Well, one way is the ONUR actually, one of the tasks is to act as a catalyst.
Right.
So we prepare programs, we do programs, because since it's a nationally recognized institution and with President Chandrika Bandaranaike's profile as a national leader and accepted by government, we have inputs into various, so there will be training programs. If you recall, during the time President Chandrika Bandaranaike was president, there was a period, it was during the war, the armed forces had come in for severe attack, saying that they had been involved in human rights violations and so on. There was an intensive program of training by the ICRC. And teaching them human rights values, international humanitarian law, and the army completely changed after that. In fact, I recall when I was a member of the National Human Rights Commission, when I went to Jaffna, the people of Jaffna were very happy with the service commander who was in charge there because of the attitude. So it is, that is what we are trying to do now, even the police and armed forces and all, in consultation with the relevant ministries. Of course, we work through the ministries, line ministries, for instance, the Ministry of Law and Order has to come into play. We will try to change these attitudes through a process of training. And you see, the, when the leadership gives the signal clearly, the message gets across. Because when the leadership gives conflicting signals, then people lower down find it difficult. And I want to just complete what I was saying earlier. The importance of institutions being strengthened is that when incidents like those that are taking place now take place, ordinary people who are scattered all over the country should not have to reach out to their MP or to a minister or to the president or prime minister. The system must immediately start working. They should be able to access the system and get relief. That is the importance of strengthening institutions.
Do you see sufficient leadership in the present government towards ensuring national unity and reconciliation?
I see in the present government a great commitment to do so. Great commitment. Now, even this process of constitution reform to address the issues relating to the conflict, particularly bringing the Tamil National Alliance into this process, is an indication, despite strong opposition from certain sections. So clearly at the leadership level there is a great commitment, but unfortunately you're working still with systems that have deteriorated over a period of time. So sometimes these don't get translated into action as quickly as one should. But having said that, since the government has been in power or in office for 2.5 years, it's time that those systems have been changed. But of course, as you know, this is a coalition government. They are sometimes saddled with issues which are unnecessary to handle the main focus of government. So they get caught up in those, and attention is taken. One of the big problems I see in the government is sometimes indecision, sometimes slowness to act. These are sometimes because of this coalition politics and all the time looking over the shoulder at the opposition. So, but I have no doubts that the leadership in the country at the moment is for this whole process of national reconciliation. And indeed, the commitment of the president and the prime minister, the people, they got a mandate. That was one of the critical factors, among other things like abolishing the executive presidency and so on.
Mr. Yusuf, the Prevention of Terrorism Act has been called a draconian law. There is a draft, a policy framework document in place called the Counterterrorism Law. However, a consultation hasn't really taken place with regard to the document, and the PTA still exists. How do you view this?
Yes, now, as you rightly say, the PTA has been viewed as a draconian law. And the new draft that has come up, I've not had the opportunity to study it, but I've had a quick glance. But reading from what people who have studied it say, this seems to be worse than the previous law. So there has to be a process of consultation, so that while addressing the security concerns of the state and the people, you must also ensure democratic norms. One of the big flaws in legislation like the PTA, that it leaves room for abuse, where victims fall prey. So even in the process of bringing law and order, though that process of bringing law and order is made more difficult, democratic norms must be ensured so that individual rights are not safeguarded. Now again, that means comes back to the whole question of institution. Now if you look at the police, the last 30-40 years, those who have come into the police force have worked only under emergency regulations, where the normal laws of the country have been suspended, where the normal laws which provide safeguards for individuals have been suspended, and they have been used to working under those and that setup. And that's why even torture has become more easy to inflict on people, because the safeguards were not there. So now we have to retrain these people to function under a normal law. We don't have emergency. So in the same way, there must also be laws while ensuring the security of the state, the people and so on, that does not leave room for abuse.
So are you saying, Mr. Yusuf, that institutional reform and training of those in state institutions hasn't really been done up to now in a comprehensive manner?
It's, to my knowledge, it has not been done. Because it's only more recently that the emergency has been lifted in the last several years. Now I cannot really recall when it was lifted, but I don't think there has been training to reorient the police or the army or anything.
That's a massive flaw.
That's a massive flaw. But again, it's not an excuse. But trying to understand why it has happened, as I said, the government has a whole lot of things on its plate. So sometimes I suppose they miss out on these things. Still, you face the problem head on.
Mr. Yusuf, what are the challenges that you see as a member of the Board of Governors at the Office for National Unity and Reconciliation? When you go out into the field, say the north, the east, the south, what are some of the concerns that people have with regard to national unity and reconciliation?
Well, ultimately, anything that people measure, they measure in relation to their personal lives.
Right.
Now, in the north, for instance, many of them have lost their loved ones. Some of them know what has happened. Some of them don't know what has happened. That is why this office for missing persons and all comes, because they need, a human being needs closure.
Sure.
They need to know what has happened, and then you make up your mind to accept. But when it's uncertain, even during the time of the armed conflict, I have met people. I remember a relation of mine who was in the army. Fairly high officer, he disappeared. But several years after that, the parents were still hoping that he was actually alive, that maybe he was kept under custody and so on. So this is a natural human yearning. So these things have to be addressed. Then there are many women-headed households. They have to be given some livelihood so that they can live with dignity.
So these programs are already being done, right?
Yeah, it is being done. It is being done. But again, as I said, sometimes there are bottlenecks, sometimes financial constraints. Mm. Now, what one of the things ONUR is doing is psychosocial support, because there have been, people are traumatized. So that is another area which contributes or is part of the healing process. So these things are happening. The people, as I said, Sri Lanka is greatly blessed with goodwill of people at the grassroots level. Even though this dense, that in the last 30 years these suspicions have grown, still if you see, there is, I can give you so many instances, I'm sure you know many, where people have reached out, whether they are Sinhalese, Tamils or Muslims. During the tsunami, the distinction between the LTT and the soldiers blurred. So the soldiers were helping LTTs, LTTs were helping. Then even in this Mitha Tomonla tragedy, everywhere. And I remember even in the 83 conflict, when the mobs were walking down the road in Colombo 5, Mr. Pullanayagam, the late Mr. Pullanayagam, one of Sri Lanka's outstanding lawyers, who was appearing for Kuttimani. Kuttimani was sort of a symbol of the LTTs, and he was known as Kuttimani's lawyers. When the mob came down the road, the Sinhalese people of that area, mainly poor people, came out and stood and said, "Don't do anything to this man, he's our man." Sinhalese people. So you see, that's a common humanity that is there among our people. So we have to tap into that.
Why isn't it being done?
Well, it's not that it's not being done. It is being done. Of course, as I said, there are forces for political or other reasons who are acting contrary to that, either intentionally or otherwise. But these small groups which act counter are really, their voices are out of proportion to their influence. We hear them louder in the sense, not in the sound, but in, you know, presence and so on. I don't want to mention names here because they are not here otherwise. So these voices, they create insecurity in the minds of the ordinary man. So that is the thing that we have to counter when you are leading the process.
Mr. Yusuf, this government of good governance came into power or service with a promise of good governance, as well as to ensure that national unity reconciliation is strengthened and ensured. Going forward, how positive can we be about this actually taking place? And that will be my final question to you.
Well, I think we can be very positive in the sense, because we can see that, as I said, the leadership and the others are committed to that. But the problem is sometimes political processes can derail this. So that is why even action on other fields to ensure that the government succeeds in its overall objective, what the government does must impact on the lives of the people. Like, to use a phrase which a president I've heard him use, "Minisunge angata danendone." So So that is the critical thing, because however much we have conceptual good ideas and so on, unless it's translated into meaningful benefit to the people, that may not generate what we want to achieve.
Thank you very much, Mr. Javed Yusuf, for this very constructive dialogue. Member of the Board of Governors of the Office for National Unity and Reconciliation. We wrap up Newsline with that. We'll see you again tomorrow.
Thank you.